Can you quantify the damage that baboons are doing? Do you know what the exact damage they're causing? Can you give me figures? Is it a thumbsuck or do you know it? Is this problem increasing? Does it have a historic precedent? They were always baboons. Is the problem now increasing? Are there other agricultural sectors involved? And I'm thinking specifically of forestry. What is the relationship between your problem and plantation forestry? Do we have any militant pro-primate groups here? Anybody here from the Baboon Lovers Association, the Vervet Monkey? Of course, and the most important question, I think, of all, is: do we know? Can we say with some certainty who's doing the damage? Can you tell me that troop B is the bastards, and troop C doesn't eat macadamias, for instance? We are dealing with primates. Of course, we're all primates. And they cause massive damage in agriculture across Africa. We know that. I'm going to skip something. I'm keeping this presentation here. You can come back to it. It's for your use. But what I've known from my travels in Africa is that baboon or primate damage is widespread. From gorillas down to vervets, they cause trouble wherever they occur. Simply because they are primates. They're clever. They learn. They imitate, much like children. In many parts of Africa, you find that children cannot go to school because of the incredible pressure of primate damage on their parents' crops. They have to stay at home to keep the beasts out of their crops. Another example. Now, one of the points of departure, I think, of managing any problem is the statement by Sutherland: "Is species management is an admission of failure. We have cocked up so badly that we have to now manage them. This means that we've put our farms where there used to be baboons, which is human. But the fact that we are managing them means that we've done something wrong in the past in terms of general husbandry. You know, the biblical thing, thou shalt have dominion kind of thing. So, the management of a problem like primates is a multidisciplinary one, and it's not simple. The answer is very simple. We all know what it means. The ideal, in an ideal world, you have to exclude the problem. In other words, there's a fence, there's a wall, there's a big moat or a river, so the bastards can't get in. That would be the ideal. But unfortunately, we live in a highly dynamic... Sorry, you... shall I stay in one spot?
No.
So either we exclude them, or we change their behavior, which can be done, because they're clever. But the answer lies in an integrated approach. There will never be only one answer. I have one answer and you all like it, but it's not the answer. So the point of departure is that we are in this district dealing with what I would consider a strategic product. This is the livelihood of a lot of people depend on production and profit. Otherwise, you know, we work for the church. We have to make profits, we have to make money, preferably a lot of money, in order to plow back and manage. But we also need to consider the fact that we are dealing here, unfortunately, with an animal which is a higher primate. It's a clever thing, it looks at, you know, that kind of thing of mother with baby, you know, an och, sis doch, fui doch kind of thing. And whatever you do, will react, or will cause massive reaction. I've dealt with baboon problems in forestry. I've been called anything under the sun. Murderer, you know, lynch you have no idea of the insults I've had to bear. They are problems because they're so highly adaptive. You can teach a baboon Rachmaninoff's second piano concerto, you just have to keep on, you'll do it in the end. They're enormously clever, and that's why they are enormously successful. I have, by dint of my brief, excluded vervets, but I hear now that vervets are here a big problem as well, so float that one. So let us confine ourselves. Please keep simongos out of it. Do you, anybody have simongos?
No.
Do they cause damage? Not really. Anyway, so let us look. I have to take you, unfortunately, through the whole suite of options that we have. The one is shooting. We all know you take your rifle, there sit, you put on your wife's dress, you use another car, and you know, and you shoot the... it's true, these baboons know who's going to shoot, you know that. If shots are consistently placed, it's highly effective, as we know. We also know that this kind of ad hoc shooting has enormous wounding capacity. Animals will be wounded. The second point of departure here is that you would also know from experience, all of you would know, that if you don't shoot correctly, you will actually stimulate the growth of a baboon troop. You take out the alpha male, there's a huge unleashing of libido. They all start screwing. And there's an absolute tsunami of babies. It happens very quickly if you don't know what you're doing. You can see exactly where I'm aiming. Now, here we come to your Temik question. Temik and a number of poisons are highly effective, we know that. The problem here being, you know, I don't know if you, some of you have used 1080, I mean that's banned now, but yes, as it's deadly. The drawback of administering poison to a highly social animal is legion. You know what happens if you put out 5 oranges full of teledrin or Temik. An alpha male would eat 3 of them and fight everybody off, leave half an orange, and a baby or a mother will eat half the orange and then spend the next 5 weeks coughing away, you know, feces full of blood, etc. It's a very, very difficult thing to control if you cannot saturate your prey with poison. It's extremely difficult. Secondly, there is huge collateral damage. You know what happens with poison. Gifsteek. I know from the Namibia farmers, kom ons gaan 'n bietjie gif steek. Tannie makes a few frikadels, you take out the wolve gif, you know, you just drive through the veld. And of course you take out the jackals, but you take out everything else. Suboptimal poisoning. So let me say from the very beginning that poisoning is certainly not an option. Although highly effective. Now, the monkey lovers say, sterilize them. Now, what do you do with an entire troop of sterilized criminals? They do exactly what they've done before sterilization. Secondly, we all know that baboon troops are dynamic. They're just like the Dutch Reformed Church. They stich af, you know, and then they come. They go to another troop, and then if they're not all sterilized, it's not an option. People say, well, you can have long-term, these fashionable little things you put under the woman of your life's arms, 3 years no babies. Who's going to catch them? Who is going to anesthetize them? Who's going to cut all these little tubes? It's not an option. We could scare them. Of course we could scare them. It means the constant scaring of a dedicated troop of scarers. The scaring fraternity. Wow! And they all run away to your neighbor. where they cause exactly the same problem. It fails consistently because they are territory bound, and you will simply scare them into the arms of your neighbor. So whatever you do to scare a baboon, it's not going to help for long. Or a monkey, for that matter. The dyed in the wool animal managers say electric fencing. This is fine if your entire farm is planted on a rugby field. You live in broken country. Have you seen what happens if a leopard takes a klipspringer next to you? He takes 50 meters of fence plus the klipspringer out. Baboons can pole vault, I kid you not. They sit in trees like this. Over the fence. It doesn't work. It works if you put up, like game fencing, a fence that costs more than your farm. It is certainly not an option. We have all the templates, we have all the designs. You can put up exorbitant things, like on a security fence. You know, if you put it around like the things you have in town, of course the baboons won't come in. But you have a farm, you don't have a security complex. There are ways to manipulate plants so that they become toxic. I'm not talking about macadamias now, or avocados, but you can give lithium, for instance, to a plant, and nothing will eat it. So this is a possibility if you want to exclude baboons in non-edible crops. You can, like the Germans, there are a lot of things on the market. Vilex is now supposedly the most off-putting smell on it. I got a little sample, I opened it up, the secretaries ran, I couldn't get them back in the building. There's the German Jaffa, who knows German Jaffa? It's usually cow dung that you mix with slaked lime, and then you spray this all over the shop. It's a shit lot. I mean, really, it does work, but if you want to spray shit over the landscape, please try it. It doesn't work at the level of which, at the farming that we are involved in. Now, the second best option that died in the world primate lovers said, catch them and translocate them. Who wants criminals? It's like taking the mafia from Sicily and putting them in Bloemfontein. They do exactly the same kind of thing wherever you put them down. Is there a market for baboons that you know of? Who wants a troop of baboons? Have you heard of such a person? It certainly does not exist. So, you know, all the traps in the world, we know how they work and how effective they are. The dyed in the wool people say, what about supplementary? Plant something, plant mealies for the baboons so they can sit outside and eat mealies or whatever. It has been tried with macaques in Gibraltar that caused a hell of a lot of damage, so they were given hospital leftovers. They all developed diabetes. They all are now diabetic from eating too much non-banting food. You create a stimulus for getting a much larger troop. There's much more to be had. Breeding will increase dramatically, so supplementary feeding doesn't work either. Now here we come to the bad part. The only known effective way to deal with baboons that cause damage, exactly in the same way as we deal with elephants in the Kruger National Park, is to build enough traps, say in the order of, what's your baboon sizes here, troop size? 50, 100, 100? You would need 40 traps. That high, that wide, that deep. That you pre-bait. You open them up. 50 traps, not two, 50 traps. You open the trap up. You put the most fabulous food in there, mealies, for 2 weeks. It becomes the ultimate mug and bean for baboons. They sit and wait in the morning to get their mealies. And then on day X, all the traps are set together, and you catch the entire troop. and then you kill them by shooting them in the brain with a subsonic Ely hollow point 0.22 in the ear. Block. And they're dead. There's a new fashion in primate control which is called transponded, site-specific transponded response, where you take a number of the highest hierarchy animals, the top five, and you put a little transponder under the skin, which then triggers an alarm. So you have to have a wire, like, you know these dog collars, the dog bark gets a shock. So you trigger your avocado orchard or your macadamia orchard, and whenever these bastards come near it, all hell breaks loose. A transponded response. Again, if they stich af, like the Dutch Reformed Church, you have problems, because then your transponders goes to the next door troop. It's hugely labor intensive. You have to catch them, anesthetize them, put the transponder in, get them back on their feet. So, at a rubbish heap outside town, yes, this will work. I dare say it will not work on a farm. Full-time guarding. Can we afford to have each farm a dedicated squad of baboon tin slammers, whip crackers, paintball shooters? Look what's happened with baboons in the Cape Peninsula with paintballs. It is a gemors the size of Table Mountain. I predict that within the next 3 years, watch now, an innocent baby in a pram will be killed by a baboon on Cape Point. The baby will have a lolly, the baboon will give it a head bite and kill the child. Then you'll see baboon blood flowing down the streets of Cape Town. It doesn't work. It means that you have to have dedicated people that you have to put on a salary and keep them cracking whips from morning till night. And again, giving somebody else the problem. We can use this, by the way, just a, I mean, this is a normal, this is called Adobo Argentino. This is the pit bull from hell. It is more bloodthirsty than a vampire. You cannot control it. And if you say, Bobayan, you know, there'll be blood. Unfortunately also, it will take on its way Sumpy the gardener, whoever is close to this thing will be killed. So you get the blue tick, you know the blue tick. Once you've let go of the blue tick, it takes you at least 2 weeks to get it back. So whatever you do with dogs, it will work for a short while until all the goats are, you know, all the cows are slaughtered, a number of children are eaten, three gardeners disappear. We cannot even think of this. How many dogs would you need? 200 in the district? Dogo Argentinos? The way for you to start thinking is to look at an integrated system. I'm advocating one, and I'll come back to that now. But there will be, according to the site where we are and the conditions, perhaps a number of combinations of these things. My advice to you today, and I it's extremely dangerous to say, is to make a critical inventory of who is doing the damage. I will not believe that every single baboon in the district is causing damage. I think you'll agree with me. There are certain troops that are not damage prone. The behavior is known as idiosyncratic behavior. It's acquired behavior. And there will be, I guarantee you, examples of adjoining troops where the one causes massive damage and the other's not. It is crucial for you as a group of farmers to be able to tell me or anybody looking from the outside who is doing it. It's troop A. And then I say, you will have to have the moral courage to build for the entire group of farmers, appoint one baboon catcher, build 40 cages, pre-bait it, catch the troop and kill it. The reaction, I can guarantee you, will be cataclysmic. You have to prepare yourself for terrifying reaction. You are going to be screamed out of your farm. Killers, murderers, and so on. But then we have to reduce this argument back to the point is, what is the difference between farming with carrots, where you get a cutworm and you put pellets out, and shooting a baboon? The answer is there is no difference. It's both times a living creature that you have decided to take its life. Let me go back to these questions and let us start a discussion. So, you know, the conclusions is all kinds of things that you can look at. It's not relevant here. I think we need to move towards groups of people doing the same thing that say, the Farmers Union of South Africa has decided on, we have to follow this protocol, which I'll come to a little bit later. There's some references which you can look at. So, let me start the discussion right away by asking you, anybody, can anybody put a figure to the damage for this hall? Does anybody know how much damage baboons cause? Or is it just an irritation? Ooh, you don't even be honest with you. Million? How many millions? 10, 20, 3?
The worst of the problem, I think, is that the baboon takes one bite out of an adder, knows it's not right, and then throws it away and goes and picks another one.
No, I fully understand that. But I want to know, what is the damage? Can you tell me, is it an irritation because of this dropped abo? Or can you say, my farm loses 500,000 rand a year due to baboon damage?
You can't specify it, but it's plenty. You can't say how much exactly in rands, but you can see the effect under the trees, all of these shells lying there. You know you're losing a lot, but you can't say exactly how much.
I did an exercise last year by shooting a couple of monkeys towards the river, and you looked at the stomach content and looked at the damage under the trees. And on 60 hectares, I estimated monkey damage, so not baboon damage. Because we're speaking different things with macadamias. The monkey damage is more severe than the baboon. About 500,000 on 60 hectares?
Right.
Half a million?
Right.
If you take what we found in the gut, what we saw, and we made a sum and said, okay, 30 days a month, 3 months, you know, and looking at a certain selling price.
That's what I'm fishing for.
1.2 to 1.5 million on 120 ton crop max. Here is from year to year.
We get indirect damage. Little buggers are stealing the microjets.
No, that's an extremely important observation, because we can now start asking the question whether our way of management is supplying a resource that is scarce outside. In that case, I dare say water is a driving factor here. Until there is consensus for the industry, the macadamia industry or the avocado industry, giving a hard figure, even if it's an estimate, that saying the industry is losing 25 million rands worth of macadamias a year and say, for instance, 50 million or whatever, until that point you are not at liberty to act. You will not be tolerated if you say, we think it's a problem. You have to prove that it is a problem. As in forestry, which they can, you know, they can actually make an enumeration and say, these trees are 15 years old, they've been ring-barked, the growth potential is that, the loss, they can get very accurately. I conclude that, or concede that it's very difficult to put a figure to it, but there has to be a concerted effort from the industry, not from the individual, from the industry to let the powers that be, that will in the end grant you permission to do this, what the damage really is. And that I just put in the pressure cooker for you to think about. As an industry, we had a stink bug meeting. You see, the great thing to me about stink bugs is I know absolutely nothing about them, so I could really ask reckless questions. But please remember this. Please remember, what is good for the industry is good for the individual. It doesn't work the other way around. No use Europe, fanatic baboon murderer, and the rest of the industry suffers. It has to be an industry effort and program. Doesn't anybody know anything about who causes damage? Do you know the troop of baboons? There's 100 there, and they come into my orchard regularly. Do they also raid your neighbor's orchard? We have to be able to start drawing on a map who's doing the damage. If you start blanket killing baboons, this project will fail. There will be vicious reaction. It needs to be based on real data. And I know from many years of experience, many, many years, in Zimbabwe, in Namibia, and also in this country, especially up here at Sabi, where there is 200 million rands damage a year, 200 mil per year on trees. That until they got to the point that they could actually map out the territory of this troop and saying this is where it's causing damage, were they able to go ahead and take them out. There will be vicious reaction if everybody starts taking out the baboons. So we have to be able to prove that these are macadamia criminals. Do we know this?
But surely those monkeys are in your macadamia orchards, they can't be looking for robbers.
No, indeed not. But I dare say also that at night or in daytime, they don't spend their entire... Do they spend 24 hours in your orchard?
No,
they
are.
From 7 in the morning until 7 at night, they're there.
Right.
You shoot them and they'll run out and I'll come back. And
yeah, but you see, that's you shoot one or two. Now, in your case, if you can, with complete certainty, say that there's a troop of 60-plus vervets knackering my orchard, then you have a case. Then you really have a case. I'm a bit on thin ice. I'm a sort of a baboon expert more than a vervet expert. Did you know, just by the way, that it's just been found that vervets have the most complicated vocal repertoire of all the primates in the world? They have about 60 words. Boon, snake... Saloon.
Saloon.
Yeah, remember the old people
used to say,
Fadi Saloon. Nie David Fadi Saloon, that's a good one. Where was I before the saloon? What I'm aiming at is that you would have to stand together as an industry or a concerned group of farmers, clearly defined. We, the undersigned, can categorically state that the damage to our crops, which we see as a strategic crop, there is no limit at the moment to the growth potential of macadamia, as far as I can see. So it's really a growth industry, and if you do it well, there's money to be made. So we cannot afford to have it eroded by marauding primates. But there will be, have to be, and some of the older guys like me, you know, when you start talking about advanced electronic systems like GIS, which simply means a geographic information system. Now, a geographic information system can be a nice big map on a wall with a pencil in which you say, damage 2014, damage this, that, and the other. It's an accumulative system that teaches you certain patterns in behavior of animals, plants, or people. You must get your ducks in a row before you can even start thinking of controlling the problem. You will run into excess. I have been on the front page of the New York Times as baboon murderer. I kid you not. I appointed a student who fell out of love with his wife and in love with the baboons. And then when they killed the baboons, he took me to the New York Times. Dave Pepler, baboon murderer. Solely responsible for the death of God knows how many baboons. You will have terrifying reaction if you are not prepared for the consequences and if you cannot quantify your damage. So, let's start with doubts and comments and even insults. I've got a skin made of Tupperware. Any ideas? Who still wants to poison? Let's discuss these things.
What I'd like to do is maybe have a student somewhere and do some research on looking at the possibility of using a poison, not poisoning, because I don't agree with poisoning. But we should be looking at it where it should be like when you do a scout spray for stink bug. There's stink bugs, you know you can spray. The same thing happens, you see you've got monkey, you throw out a couple of pellets, only they eat them, like what happens to rats, they have to have a couple of them and then they die, and whoever eats them, nothing happens.
I would much rather shoot them. Not me. I have. It's all good and well until there sits mom with pink baby with big eyes. Who do you shoot first? The baby? So the mom's hysterical, or do you shoot the mom and the baby becomes hysterical? It's a hell of a job.
Funny enough, they don't.
I've had males actually killing male, female baby. The male, as you approach, would take the baby and kill it. It's a bloody awful job. But again, I think as far as ethics are concerned, general ethics, poisoning is a non-starter. Look, Tebek in Mutare, who knows Mutare in Yassas, they took out, I think, 4,000 baboons. They took them out in their thousands. But then, of course, the YouTube pictures come out of baboon bleeding from the anus. And you need one YouTube clip to have the entire Mahalisburg felt fall on you. It's all you need. Poisoning goes wrong. With the best will in the world. Poisoning, let's call it chemical control. Let's get away from the word poison. It is a non-starter, I'm sorry. Any other ideas, in my view?
What about just killing the males first? The leaders.
This unleashes a wave of libido on the troop. Because Pa is now gone, this means anybody can mate with anybody. The alpha male has a very specific function in the troop to decide who. Yeah, I mean, they will always catch a quickie. But generally speaking, he's in. No, they do. The students in Selangor calls it a zip. They catch a zip very quickly. But generally speaking, you will see there's huge control in a group. Alpha male directs the entire behavior of the group.
Surely then they go away and you kill the alpha male.
No! No, they just zip on the spot. They don't go away. Not at all.
Why don't they go to the...
No.
I don't know.
No, it's simply a tension releaser. And usually if you only take the males out, you will in the next season have a 20% more babies. Everybody will be pregnant. It's not an option, in my book. And we have to be brutally honest in this thing. If we can't have hidden agendas. Speak, please.
The process for vermin monkeys the same as basically baboons, or would they have to sort of change up?
Just repeat that.
So is the process the same as what you do for baboons as what you do for vermin monkeys?
The idea here is to take out the functional group, including day-old babies, that causes the damage. It's like culling of elephants. Day-old baby elephants are shot in the head. The entire troop is... elephants being a prime example, if you shoot the matriarch, the leading female, all hell breaks loose. They fight and kill each other because it's not a natural progression. The idea here is to take out everybody.
Certainly it creates a vacuum.
It does create a vacuum, but if you have a number of vacuums, if you coordinate your vacuum creation, then you manage it when the problem arises again. When the next troop comes in, acquires the habit of causing damage, you take them out as well. I mean, it sounds brutal, but that's my viewpoint. You have to keep on. It's not a one-off solution at all.
The first step would then be to, within your organizations, then get to a point that you can quantify the damage.
Yes.
Okay, and once you've done that, then you have to catch them and you have to knock them.
There is another step. And I've done this before for the forestry industry. It's the creation of a protocol. The farmers of the Nelspruit district, farming, and would like to state our intentions clearly, step by step, explaining the process. Damage will be assessed critically. Troop will be identified. Its home range will be marked so we know. This is how we're going to do it. You write a protocol. A step by step, taking responsibility for what you're going to do. If you see, let's be brutally honest, who shot a baboon in the last week? You know, 10 to 1, a few of you. Right, a few of you have done that. Now, it solved a problem temporarily. They ran away, perhaps for a day, they're back. We know for a fact, you know, that old thing of painting a baboon white, you know, running over the hill, doesn't work. It is certainly in wildlife management, in problem species management, the top problem. What happens if you have Himalayan tar on Table Mountain? You shoot the whole bloody lot, you know. But baboons are indigenous. Although I might lose agricultural extension, they are 10 to 1 a declared pest species here. Are they? Yes, they are declared. So by government gazette, they already have a status as a pest species, and a pest species by definition will be managed, must be managed, for you, in order for you to survive and make a profit. So I don't have a problem with their status. I'm sure in the baboons are declared across the entire country as pest species, as far as I know. There'll have to be a lot of homework with the authorities and saying this. And then you have to also, and this I can guarantee you, there will be a phenomenal outcry of a number of public participation meetings where Tant Hetty van Graan of Kokenaar, who has three baboons in a garage, will come. And then she'll stand there and say, "Murderers!" and so on. I've been through it a number of times.
Dave, I am involved with a sort of a trial in my area where we are looking, it's together with the University of West, in America, West Connecticut.
Yeah.
And what we are using is we use visual, sound, and smell. And the system it's a microphone that's coupled to a motion sensor with two cameras. And then we have a little bit of a bottle where we put urine in of curricle or leopard.
Yep.
And then when the motion detector picks up any movement, it sprays the urine. Next time it will make a noise, and yep, the noise is of people loading a truck, elephant, lion, there's a couple of noises.
Have you quantified the effectivity of it?
We are only starting now. What I can say to you is what I've seen is the monkeys. So far we've just observed monkeys, and they don't even move when the sound of people talking, loading trucks, car door slamming, they just keep on beating.
Who of you have used a carbide shooter for birds? You remember the old carbide shooters? It would drip and then go boom. I've seen two Egyptian geese stand on the carbide cannon going boom. This is known as habituation. If there is no direct lethal result causing grievous bodily harm, we know from Darwin's studies that it ain't gonna work. It's not working. I very much doubt. And how many of these of caracal, you'll have to have a battery like rainbow chickens of bean caracals to keep all these things full. I'm serious, you have to have 50 caracal bee dispensing machines, and it's going to work for a short while. I'm being very cynical, but I've been through this.
We've tried it on a mini farm out the Kudus Court with a gas cannon and a timer that goes off, say, every half an hour, and also a leopard roaring.
Yeah.
It was quite effective.
It was effective for a very short time. I was at a most appalling town the other day in the Karoo called Murraysburg. Who knows Murraysburg?
Yeah.
I'm walking through the veld and I hear my own voice and I think, am I going completely mad?
Yeah.
On a wind pump, an old wind pump, is a solar panel with a little radio tuned to Harris Gia. I'm talking to Amore Becker. I said to the farmer, oh, he said, jackals don't like human voices. There I sit and talk nonsense the whole bloody day. The jackals are just killing. No. I don't think so. Animals are very clever and they habituate very quickly. Very quickly. They will find that this talking and music means nothing. They will actually then go and cause damage on top of it very quickly.
He can move it all the time.
Yes, but
it is your father.
Who's going to move it?
Find baboon eggs.
You will have to have 10 per 100 hectares constantly moving. You'll have more people moving it. The movement of these things will be more effective than the apparatus. The human presence of moving it will have more effect than the machine.
Dave, I used two of them on about 60 hectares last year for the season, and quite effective, but I managed them. I had people on them the whole time. I had them switched off, so if they see that there's baboons, and this is not vermin, they definitely, they just run past it, they don't even see it, but it does work on baboons. But you have to have them off, when you see them, put them on, when they're gone again, put them off, then move it, and then put it on. It works like it, but it's peaty. It's
enormous peaty. And it does, you know, it's fine if you dedicate it enough, but it doesn't solve the community's problem. Because it's a community problem.
I'm wondering why it's necessary to have 8 traps, which obviously is a problem to shut them all at the same time. Why not one large 100 monkey size trap and you catch all of them?
No, that's just killing them. How? Do you go in there and shoot them?
Ooh. No, I mean you're catching the trap.
Yes.
Like you suggested.
Yeah.
But why have many traps? Why can't you just have one big trap?
Many traps are portable. If you work them out well, you put them on a flat bed, one lorry. You can't move a big one. Secondly, if you have more than 3 animals in a trap, try and shoot them. You don't get near them. It's an absolute dishwasher.
Okay, answer.
And there is exactly where you don't want to wound, that you want to be lethal with every shot.
And not too noisy.
I've tried traps. I've probably got about 30 traps in. I've taken them all out of the field and put them behind this shed. And that worked.
Why? How long did you pre-bait?
We first initially had a piece of timber where they had to stand on, trigger the trap to go to the door. That didn't work. They went around the timber to go and get whatever they wanted to get. And eventually I put in something where they had to pull the bait.
Yeah.
That worked a bit. We actually caught now one baboon and 3 monkeys in the last couple of days.
Okay.
But they've now decided not to go into the trap. It doesn't matter what you do.
Your troop has now been habituated. they know the traps, and they will know it as long as they live, and they will actually transfer the fear to the younger ones by baboon culture or by monkey culture. The idea of having 40 or 50 traps is to go fresh into an area that has not been trapped, put them down, lock them, and pre-bait until every morning the entire troop goes in to feed. People say, let's do it. Doesn't work like that. You have to stick and make absolutely sure that the whole troop goes in every time. I feel like a murderer, but it is the only practical way of dealing with this problem, is to take out the troop that is causing the damage, because it's cultural. There is very little difference, I'll come back to you now, little difference between shooting 50 or shooting two a week for 5 or 15 years. There's no difference really, is there?
What we found is that with the numbers down, they don't go into the lands as often because there's more food available and the troop sizes are down. And so it is a manageable thing where you could say, look, at this stage we've got no damage.
I want to hear.
As soon as you find damage, perhaps take them out. And when you've done that, then they come where they would have been in my lands like 3-4 times a day. And now I see them maybe once, twice, in 2 weeks, 3 weeks.
I dare you to take aerial photographs. Now, this area has been well photographed since the 1930s because of forestry. There are sets and sets of photographs. The increase of agricultural land has been in the order of a few thousand percent. We have dramatically encroached on the natural habitat of a lot of animals. Some have just simply moved away, but baboons tend to stick to a mountain range or a sleeping place. This is what the Germans call the problems of Lebensraum. There isn't enough food in many cases in the fell to sustain a group like that. Now, by eating avos, macadamias, and what have you, sweet potatoes or whatever, they are artificially kept at very high levels. We need more discussion.
I want to ask, we've got macadamias, but we also need papayas. Do you know if we get an avocado for papayas? Sweet and more palatable fruit. We don't really have a problem with it per se. We're maybe fortunate the way that we're isolated. We don't border onto many other farms. We've just got a gay farm next door. They in the past used to take cheap papayas and building up a gay and dump it out of the fields in their thing. And it seemed like they created a more favorable condition elsewhere.
This is one form of supplementary feeding that I was referring to. But it's rare to find a geographic location where this works. It's not a general prescription. And that's why I said, perhaps, looking at the whole range of options, some might be applicable to you. If you have a source of... If you live next to a grain silo and you can get the sweepings, or whatever, you can actually, like a vulture restaurant, keep the baboons away from you quite easily. But it's not a general... a general prescription, and secondly, I again plead for perhaps a combination of things. If you have a troop or an orchard right next to your house, get a bloody Dogo Argentino and keep it clean. But you cannot be in every orchard every minute of the day. You can't.
Dave, I farm down at Primate Court and Barber. Literally hundreds of thousands of rands on wages to keep monkeys and baboons out of sugarcane lands, and now we're starting with the macadamias. I was joking when I spoke about the thing just now, because that's a no-no. Okay? What I've been thinking is, if you can have something like an aesthetic, and you bake the food that you put out for them, and find the whole day lot they're sleeping, shoot them then. Because in that way you don't poison the jackal and the vulture and all that.
No, I catch your drift. There's less stress.
Is there something like that? Because I tell you what, they call me Mazondam Femi down there, because that's hectares that they just clean up. They clean out the sugarcane field half a hectare here, hectare there. You've got 2-3 guys chasing them. You can't give anybody a gun to go shoot these things. You don't have the time to go and do it yourself. But you've got to do something. Sugarcane is not such an expensive crop as macadamias, but the same thing there. We're surrounded with the only farm there in the bush.
Yeah.
And these things come from all over. You ask me which fruit causes the damage. It's the one that's in the orchard.
Yes. Yeah, no, I take that. But unfortunately, in order to be legitimate, you will have to have some form of identification. Because otherwise it becomes ad hoc. So, you know, you're just catching or shooting on sight. As for the anesthetic, yes, they do, such anesthetics do exist, but there is no way you would get your hands on it, ever. Mostly because there are a number which I'm not at liberty to talk about, but that mimic a heart attack, you know. And this would be the perfect way to get rid of your wife, because it doesn't show. it doesn't show. In post, no, it doesn't show in post-mortem.
You've got a name there.
Cross my farm. So there are very good reasons why they're not available. It's because they're so incredibly lethal, and they do not manifest in post-mortem. No way.
And what about finding a sleeping area or roosting area? Are they persistently in one tree every night?
No, they usually, but they will have 4 or 5, generally speaking. The reason why they're not in the same one at the same is because of all the droppings. It's too much shit in one place, and also for ectoparasites. So they move around for very good hygienic reasons. You know, the drawl is dry by 2 days' time, you can go back. But they would have a very, very highly structured selection of sleeping places. Again, you know, go in there at night, you think they're all going to sit and cower, they scatter like hell. That's what they do when a leopard comes. They don't sit there and be eaten, they just all explode, like popcorn.
Do they normally sleep in the trees or on the ground?
It depends on the topography. If you have an escarpment, I can guarantee you there'll be a wall crown somewhere where they fall. If they in open plantation, they will sleep in trees. They will even sleep on the ground if there's sort of a flay area, much like gorillas.
I shot some little monkeys in the trees, and I just left the carcass there. And I see they're not going to these trees anymore.
I don't know enough about it. I don't. It's the first time I've heard that.
They don't go to the trees.
Look. You will know from Karoo farmers that have both problems with jackals and with baboons that they usually string them up on the fences. You know, that's where the real trouble starts when YouTube gets hold of that. So there is some sort of aversion, I would imagine, but I don't think it's predictive.
Dave, no, that doesn't work. I shot 4 monkeys the other day, and I hanged them up on the fence like that. And the same afternoon, I drove past in the monkeys.
I somehow don't think it's highly effective. I don't think so.
So do you suggest you shoot them and take them away?
The protocols that I've worked with says that you will dig a trench and put them in there and put slaked lime on it, at least 1.5 meters thick, and cover it with gravel. There is, of course, now the question, and I don't think it will fly, Is there a market for baboon and monkey meat? Yes. I dare say there is.
You
can
turn the face away and eat it.
Yes, but you know, if you take it to Hartleaf in winter, they'll make salami of it because half of it's zebra in any case. I have advocated for a long time that we should actually break this barrier of thinking that there is not a market for body parts of primates. Go to, who's been to Durban Mooty Market? There's thousands of baboon heads, thousands of baboon feet, tails, knackers, the whole lot. But I think that will be thin ice. Then they can say, oh, you're shooting them into supply a market. Smoked monkey, I mean, you'll have a huge market in West Africa. I mean, you can stop eating bats and start getting rid of Ebola. But I've given up on that idea because it's just moving into an ethical quagmire where you might just, you know, miss them.
Right. So in contrast to some of the stuff you've been saying, we've got the parts good.
This is extremely interesting. I've never heard of this.
I know, I mean, it was very unpleasant living there once.
I'm sure. It's like having young children. There will be some, I can guarantee you, there will be some.
I didn't hear what you said.
No, he said that the vervet monkeys were caught in a cage and then starved without food and water for 3 days, screaming their heads off and then released, and then they all left because of this.
We shut them in.
After the third day. Oh, so this big noise.
Yeah.
Ah.
It's just a noise.
Of suffering.
Gave the message.
I hope they gave them the last meal.
You should have given it a little macadamia before shooting it. It's interesting, but I don't think it's going to work on a large scale. More ideas. Come on.
So we actually thought you are saying that we must, as a group, create a protocol, and can it not be turned around to maybe from Wildlife South Africa, from their side, you know, maybe quantify, if possible, let's say the damage that monkeys do on bird life.
That will be seen as part of the natural order. If the birds were sulfur-crested cockatoos at 10,000 rand each, but if they were to eat as they do, scores of eggs and young birds and snakes and whatever, it's a different ball game. There is a group which you may, I can put you in touch with them, at the University of Cape Town, who says that they manage primates, and they are behind the paintball business in Cape Town, which is certainly one of the most flawed things I've ever come across. Day in and day out, I mean, you just open a paper, houses be shat, I mean, fridges ruined, I mean, you leave a window open and 50 baboons come and ruin your house on half the peninsula. There is no way that you're going to change this behavior. But just coming back to your question, I think it would be, it's like putting a price to a sunrise, you know. What's it worth? What's a tinky egg worth? It's very difficult to quantify.
Because why I'm saying this, you know, our main problem is stink bugs, and I'm sure that there are birds also eating stink bugs. Which are affected by the monkeys. So, you know,
I'm not too sure about birds eating stink bugs. They are stink bugs for a very specific reason. And we just heard from the entomologist here that I never knew this, that about a third of this, I think, of the body is just a reservoir of stink. You know, it's a very potent. They might have parasites, but that's why they are stink bugs, is to avoid predators.
We say now we must move away from poison and stuff, lethal stuff, that I agree with. But the birds and monkeys aren't stupid. And I mean, they know adults and rats and stuff is nice edible food and it's a luxury for them, if I can put it that way. Why don't we look at maybe methods of putting bait or even rats or whatever out there that will let them feel sick, that they do become sick. It's more ethical, first of all, but that they get that connotation on. It's not nice eating that stuff.
I see what you mean, like antabuse, when you give an alcoholic an injection and they get sick when they drink alcohol. But So it's known as aversion therapy. It is, quite frankly, something I haven't considered. That's an extremely important and very valid comment. It warrants recording as a possibility to look at. I mean, you can go very quickly. You need Bota Basun will give you advice. No, look, there are many. Lithium being one. Lithium is a very, very nausea-inducing salt. And that's an interesting idea. That's a very... So, habituating.
We do a lot of spraying in the macadamia industry. What about maybe like chilies? Would that have any effect?
The element.
Yeah, sort of, it's a natural based product.
Now, you see, unfortunately, you can sell that to China, but not to Europe. The minute you start manipulating any crop, they will pick it up. And then the red flags will go up. I mean, you can sell anything to China. They will eat depleted uranium. No, I'm serious. I mean, that I think is dangerous. We know exactly there are aborticides that you could put in a subliminal level that will actually make a tree, perhaps with stink bugs, but it will also affect the fruit. And it's just a consumer thing that you will be extremely difficult to break, I suspect. It's a nice idea, but I'm beginning to like this this aversion therapy as a trial. If macadamias make you sick as hell, why eat them? That's a very fascinating idea.
I don't know if anyone here has ever eaten a small macadamia. An immature macadamia. Yeah. They taste like, they're the worst thing. They're very, very high in tannin. They're astringent. They pull your mouth together. They are horrible. So yeah. I don't think the monkeys are eating them out of choice. They have to eat them because they're dying. They need food.
Well, French say, will we, or they'll go past the abbas and they'll eat the macadamias.
Well,
they don't
I think
touch the abbas, but they go down for macadamias.
I think it's just the cost benefit. I mean, the nutritional value of a macadamia is enormous, you know. It really is. I mean, I haven't done a bomb calorimeter, but I'm damn sure that a macadamia in value is about the same as an abba. It's a hell of a concentrated food, and they're simply optimizing their diet. It makes sense. Why go and look for scorpions if you can eat macadamias? Any other thoughts from the floor? This talk is rather provocative in its brutality, but I think it's time actually to face a number of raw options. Electric fencing, dogs, guards that are all managing the troop that is causing the damage. Ethically, there are a number of what's known as priority principles. And one principle number one is that it's a biblical injunction that man shall have dominion. You know, the well-being of man, us in other words, rises above all other ethical considerations, whether it's blue whales or mosquitoes or whatever. So that's the point of departure, that we as humans have a right somehow, hopefully as custodians, not to screw things up too badly, but we have very high rights in the hierarchy of rights compared to an elephant or a lion or a gorilla or a mosquito. But if you reduce that argument, there is actually no difference between taking the life of a tick or a flea or shooting a baboon. It's the same, it's an act of a human being taking the life of a creature. But that's a reductionist argument. It would infinitely help if you could put a you know, these little pig troughs with a float on it. They'll get it immediately.
What sort of trough?
You know, you get these enameled little pig-sty troughs. It's fairly robust. It usually has a little nipple or a little float. That if it, I can guarantee you, it will. But exactly, I mean, if the little bucket is small enough, and the minute they touch it, it gives fresh water.
Okay.
And that's why not having a big sort of an old dwipdroch, you know, something very compact, I am convinced it will. It's used for many other species in America for antelope. They have what they call gallinaceous guzzlers, and they have these small that constantly supplies fresh water. It never gets frogged. It's certainly worth a try. So we come to this point of what is the way forward? I think as a, are you a coherent group? Is there sort of an agricultural union? Do you guys talk to each other? Right, I would imagine so.
Is it the Inuit?
That's the poor man. Where you have to choose, have it, slides remain here, the options, my recommendation, the dangerous one, stands, and that you should have, without me, a discussion on the way forward. You must place your industry strategically. It must be clearly stated what it's worth and where it's going. This is what, don't talk gross national product, but this is what you do for the region. These are the numbers of people you employ in this industry. This is the footprint. This is the social footprint of the industry. You have to do a bit of homework and say, in effect, this is what the industry is worth. 20% is being lost to primate damage. Therefore, we suggest that we will now approach this problem through a protocol, which we all agreed with. Because I can guarantee you, if you're all going to do your own thing, it'll catch up with you at one stage or the other. I will leave my email here, or you have it. Mm. So if you have any other questions, please feel free to don't say here while eating a sandwich under the full moonlight, looking at my little fire, I happen to think about vervets. Ask me a question, I'll say yes or no. But you're most welcome to talk to me once you've started teasing out your options. And I think if one of the main things is to be open about it and be honest about it. Don't try and hide what you're doing. Even if it's scary, don't hide it. Say, this is what we're doing as an industry. Speak more through the industry.
Dave, is there a specific design of those traps?
Yeah.
You would recommend, you know, it doesn't help us reinventing the wheel.
No. As a matter of fact, I can put you in touch with the baboon teams working for forestry. They perfected these traps.
Is there a website?
They won't put their traps on the website. But I'm still in touch with the guys. I can link you up.
Yeah.
It would be actually if,
please,
if two or three elder statesmen drive over to just up the road and go and see what they're doing and learn from them. Say, tell me about your experience. How do you deal with the public? How do you deal with the media? They've been doing it for years. And it's, you know, now and again it erupts, but it's mainly legal. I wrote the protocol, it stands. They work according to it, and they're managing their problem effectively. They're not winning, but they have saved hundreds of millions of rands by simply sticking to a plan.
We sit under about forestry, and we've got quite a few project up here in that area that I know control the booms, but they keep pretty much the load out because there's a lot of left they get, so they control it. But rather than having a public face, they control the areas where they don't want to see what's actually happening.
Let me put you in touch with the big guys who are doing it. And I really think it would be worth making an appointment saying, we as an industry, you know, how can we work together? Perhaps, you know, you could take 10% of the flak, but learn from how they, it's been a torturous process. But it's sorted in Namibia, it's sorted in this country now, it's going on. And actually two of the most vehement opponents are now friends of mine, you know, two American primatologists, we in constant You know, the first night I said, would you like to have some baboon steak? And they both burst into tears. How dare you? They don't understand our humor at all. But I think a very good move would be to go send a little delegation, official, make an appointment with the forestry guys. I'll try and facilitate them and see how they're doing it. I haven't been involved there for about 3 or 4 years, you know, I've moved on to other nonsense. But make an alliance. Trap sizes, it's all there. They might even in the meantime have found some alternative control measures that I'm not aware of. I'm deeply interested, and we've really set me thinking about diversion. It's worth, very worth trying. You just have to find the right stuff. But I'm sure there is some sort of, tend to be lithium or something, in a very low dose, and make them sick as hell. I'm afraid that I got up at 3 o'clock this morning, and I have to actually now fly back to Stellenbosch because I'm off again somewhere else. I'll have to go and look at my diary. But thank you for your attention. I hope that there's some. I hope there's hope that these problems can be addressed in a structured manner, but only if you stand together. Thank you.